All right, denizens of the DAG, welcome back. I'm going to get killed after this. Anyway, I have another pun, but I'll save that for the Q&A. Anyway, so I want to introduce our second set of talks from Susanna and Matt here at Receipt Bank, who have been kind enough to host us. They're going to be talking us through some things to remember if you come from an engineering background and you're teaching analysts who are starting to work with DBT to make that migration go smoothly and get them excited about the possibilities. So without any further ado, I'm going to hand it over to them. Welcome, Susanna and Matt.
So, hi, everybody. Who here has heard of Receipt Bank? Oh, a fair few. Great. Well, for those of you that haven't, I'm going to give a quick introduction. So Receipt Bank is the best tool for small businesses to get on top of their finances, manage their cash flow, and really start running their business. We work between small businesses and accountants to enable the accountants to be more productive and act as true advisors and allow the small businesses to do more of what they enjoy. So we do this by enabling them to better gather data and to take out some of their manual tasks. So Receipt Bank processes over 10 million documents a month for over 300,000 small businesses and over 9,000 accountancy firms around the world. So that's 10 million pieces of paper that no longer have to be saved, filed, transcribed, or worried about. So I want to talk to you a bit about the history of the analytics team at Receipt Bank, because that sets the scene for the rest of the talk. So a couple of years ago, the analytics team consisted of a couple of analysts embedded across various functions at Receipt Bank. And these analysts were in charge of the data within their function and building out the model, the data model within their worldview. And Looker had been implemented a little while earlier, and this enabled these analysts to have a far-reaching impact. They could then build reports and dashboards and explores that could be interrogated by those all across the company. About a year and a half ago, the first centralized BI team was formed at Receipt Bank, and their remit was to start reporting across function and to ensure that definitions were consistent across the company and that numbers that were produced by one function aligned with those produced by another. And I was part of that team. And what we found when we joined was that it was all a bit of a mess. Made perhaps unsurprisingly, without any oversight when the data model was being built, there was very little consistency and there was a lot of duplication. So what Looker almost in a way had allowed this to happen. Looker is not designed for building out a complete data structure. It doesn't allow you to reuse code easily and doesn't allow for testing. At the same time, Receipt Bank had grown rapidly. We had expanded in terms of size, but also in the amount of data we had, the amount of data sources we were using, and also the questions and the variety of questions that were being asked. And so we really came to the point where we needed to use a better tool. Over this time, also the analytics team had become more and more centralized until what we have today, which is a centralized team. And this enabled us to work better together and learn from each other. So we sort of embarked on this journey to implement this new tool, which was DBT. So why did we decide to use DBT? Why did we choose DBT? Well, we really enjoyed the fast iterative cycle that Looker enabled us to have. We could change things quickly in the models, and then they could be rolled out and people would be able to see the results straight away. However, we really needed to start enabling that the code we produced was of production quality and test against it. And what DBT has allowed us to do is run tests against every single one of our models that runs every time DBT runs in production and also in the development branch. The data layer had been built up organically and had been built up into from lots of different pieces and kind of into some giant form. And what we really then started needing to happen was to have some sort of organization and structure to this model. And by well organizing our DBT files, we've been able to really follow through a raw data source from the beginning, so from the raw source all the way through, see how it's transformed within the data structure and to the final materialized tables. And finally, we really needed to start thinking about how do we build for the medium to long term, rather than the short term, as we had done previously. And by implementing DBT along with code reviews and version control, we can now ensure that any changes we make are for the long term. They're also aligned with what we have going on elsewhere in the company, and they're consistent. Now, because our modeling was held in Looker originally, it meant that sort of by virtue of that, the analysts became the owners of the modeling layer and the data structure. So we embarked on this journey as a group of analysts, starting out with DBT for the first time. And we definitely learned a few things along the way. And that's what my colleague Matt here is going to talk to you a bit about what we learned during this journey.
Thanks, Susanna. As Susanna mentioned, she's given you the context of Receipt Bank and mentioned that we're all a bunch of analysts in different parts of the organization, and we really owned the code for that domain. When we formed into like a centralized team and started working more closely with the data engineers, we found there was a few areas where our knowledge didn't quite meet what the engineers had, and there was a sort of, they took that for granted in ways. So I thought I might talk about what engineers should remember when working with analysts. And basically, without a background in data engineering, we almost didn't know what we didn't know. So what we were good at. So basically, the analytics team had a really good understanding of data at Receipt Bank. Like, we knew the relevance for each data source. We knew what the source of truth was for any of the business logic. And we were quite good at knowing like who to speak to or who the stakeholders were for certain questions and projects. We were not so good though at moving away from this world where we built all these models in Looker. So we were really used to constructing these models, which were not normalized. They were built to answer specific questions or to perform like specific functions, and we weren't able to broadly apply those across the business. So we really needed a crash course from the data engineers to understand like data best practices. So we needed to know how to create like a data mart with dimension and fact tables, and we need to know how to plan and build out a DAG in which we could take some of our bigger pieces of code and break it down into smaller, more manageable incremental models, which we could then use to reference by other models downstream. As well, like, none of us had ever really done much testing before, so we really needed like a helping hand from the engineers to understand what sort of tests we need to run and how to test the sort of assumptions we were making of certain sources. When it came to like writing SQL, we all had like a fair amount of experience writing general select statements and doing fairly complex transformations and like writing out like calculations and arriving at an endpoint which we could do further analysis on. But we had never really done a lot of the SQL statements that a data engineer might typically use. So for example, like the create, insert, and merge sort of statements. So not knowing that meant that we didn't really understand a lot of how DBT works under the hood when it compiles like a bit of SQL and sends it off to the data warehouse. Because we didn't have that knowledge, we also had trouble interpreting like certain error messages when we got them back, when we did something silly like create a incremental model which wasn't supposed to be incremental or something like that. And then also another thing we struggled with, well, firstly, because we were doing a lot of work in Looker, we were all very familiar with writing code in Looker, creating branches, doing commits and pushing code and then merging it back into the master branch. But this is all like fairly easy in Looker because it handles a lot of it. So when we moved to dbt, we really struggled with that at first. I know dbt now ships with a like IDE in which you can do a lot of this stuff fairly simply, but at the time that wasn't available to us, so we had to stick with the command line. Which was not fun. So yeah, I wouldn't say that the command line is necessarily friendly for beginners. We really need a lot of handholding from the data engineers for a lot of that. So that's really about it from us. I think like those are the main sort of things that we found when we were doing our initial migration to dbt. And I think had a lot of those things been front of mind for the data engineers, that would have really helped us transition and upskill into becoming like data analyst engineers and doing that work using dbt. That's about it.